2005, and JoJo's Bizarre Adventure mangaka Hirohiko Araki has opted to wipe his two-decade-long storyline in favor of something completely fresh. The pages of Shonen Jump open, and Steel Ball Run is born. JoJo's is more complicated than your average manga, as it opts for a part system rather than the typical shonen formula of a wider saga composed of arcs. It's important to understand the part structure, because it allows Araki to reinvent himself for every new part, and this exclusivity of parts is what allows me to zoom in on Steel Ball Run, and doubly so because it's set in a brand new universe, bringing a whole host of new risks and storylines. To get specific, the structure of Steel Ball Run is through 24 standard-sized volumes composed of 95 chapters. There are a total of 22 what I like to call mini-arcs in the series, which are all quite short compared to your average arc in your average manga, the typical Steel Ball Run arc being 3-4 chapters. Okay, that's all you need to know. Now, let's get into part one. For a quick introduction and context to the story, I will be briefly summarizing the characters of the story and their initial characterization. The plot of Steel Ball Run is based on the Steel Ball Run race, organized by the Baron Steven Steele, and motivated by the cash prize of $50 million. Steven Steele organized it to, in theory, achieve someone's American dream with that $50 million. Steel Ball Run is interesting because two protagonists effectively assume the role of one JoJo, but we do meet the Jo-Bro, or sidekick, first. The chaotic Italian cowboy, Gyro Zeppeli. Gyro is a Neapolitan executioner, attempting to win the Steel Ball Run race to garner the cash needed to grant amnesty to a child falsely placed on death row back in Italy. He wields the execution device which holds the namesake for this part, the steel balls, and he does this through the ancient technique of the spin. But what comes with these fatal weapons is the burden of being a royal executioner, which I will explore in Chapter 2. Through an encounter with the steel balls, the main protagonist, Johnny Joestar, becomes fascinated with Gyro. Johnny is a paraplegic, and a formerly famous horse racer whose career ended after he was shot by a passerby who got angry that Johnny tried to cut in line for a movie theater because he thought he was more deserving to get in early because of his excessive hubris that he had built up due to his fame. But at the start of Steel Ball Run, Johnny is introduced as hopeless and frail. But a quick encounter with Gyro's steel balls allows Johnny to move his legs momentarily, and that moment gave him a brief sense of optimism. Johnny subsequently begs Gyro to allow them to team up, and after some brief conflict through the first checkpoint of the race, they find each other to be mutually beneficial. Johnny and Gyro's relationship would prove to be the driving factor in both characters' development, which strengthens their bond in unraveling the mystery of what the Steel Ball Run race truly is, a plot to gather the corpse parts of Jesus Christ in order to assemble them and power up the main villain, the President of the United States. Through their encounters with the corpse parts, Johnny and Gyro face henchmen of the President in battle, as their goals twist and turn into eventually attempting to take down the President. Also, Johnny develops his stand through an encounter with the corpse, allowing him to use Gyro's technique of the spin to shoot his fingernails as bullets, in increasingly complex ways as his stand evolves right along with his spirit. So with all that established, let's get into the fun stuff. The True Man's World arc being the story that can best hold its own in the series is no accident. Its seclusion plot-wise is only one half of its isolation, with the storytelling implications being the other half with more appeal, at least in my opinion. To begin this segment, I would like to talk about Ringo Rodigan, the main villain of this arc, who happens to be probably my all-time favorite manga character, so apologies in advance if I'm constantly rolling really cool-looking panels up. Anyways. Araki gave this man his own philosophy that I don't think I've seen any other manga even try to attempt with the same level of complexity that Steel Ball Run does. Araki achieves this effect through the point of seclusion, which I just mentioned. Isolation is an important tie into what I think the antithesis of this arc is, what I like to call the Thomas Jefferson complex. The Jefferson complex, as I have taken the liberty to define, is the desire to have a society of independent farmers who mind their own business, prove themselves, believe that individualism is the greatest liberty the US has to offer. Ringo's establishment, along with his arc, fit this complex perfectly. Ringo lives by himself in the woods, forcing anyone that crosses his path to challenge him to a duel. That will inevitably push himself to the limit. He does this through his stand, Mandom, which has a really cool design, both visually and story-wise. Its primary ability is to rewind time by 6 seconds, which he does through a watch connected to his stand. Ringo can basically spam the rewind to prevent any enemy escape from his land, and thus locking them into a duel that will enhance Ringo's combat skills. Ringo doesn't just use these fights for combat, though. More interestingly, he uses each fight as a vehicle to push his mental state to the limit. I think Ringo himself can explain how he uses a duel best. A fair duel will allow me to grow as a human being. Devoid of pettiness, a murder attempted with the darkest of intentions will raise me towards sacred heights. I am yet incomplete as a human. There are things that I must overcome. Divinity is a pursuit, and that is why I have not hidden anything from you. My ability, my objectives. I have no reason to lie. So, what we can gather from that is that Ringo is obsessed with self-improvement. But why is that? Why does he see every human encounter as an opportunity to have a fight to the death to improve his so-called divinity? The answer to this question can be found in his childhood, where he didn't have the luxury of improving himself. His family was dirt poor, without a father, and he suffered a horrible skin condition in which anything that scratched him would cause life-threatening blood loss. Due to this condition, Ringo was confined to a dark cabin in the middle of the woods, constantly being coddled by his mother to keep him safe. To make things worse, a soldier came into his family's one-room cabin one night to sexually assault him. Thankfully, Ringo was able to defend himself. He saw it as an opportunity to finally stand on his own 2 feet. Ringo executed the soldier with his own gun, and his skin condition faded away. He made up his mind, now free from the binds of claustrophobic lifestyles, became spiteful of those unwilling to change their circumstances, and transformed his life into following the true man's path, in order to, in his own words, become a human worthy of being useful to this world. Ringo's desire for battle is why our characters meet him physically, but what makes the difference in the end is their mental struggle. The mental battle in this arc is like the clashing of two stones, each with their own perspective on individualism. The clash results in a sharp arrowhead with the positive aspects of individualism remaining, and the carved out, unused rocks acting as a warning to the negative extremes of individualism. Gyro enters this rock fight, as I'm using the analogy, still tied to the burden of his family, causing him to come in second in 2 consecutive checkpoints of the race because of how much of a burden it's putting on him. Ringo immediately identifies this, as he calls Gyro a conformist, seeing him as having everything he needs to play defense, but no sense of self. He can only react. Ringo doesn't even humor him in battle. He wants to fight Johnny, who he sees as someone who wouldn't hesitate to kill if the situation called for it. It is this difference of pushing oneself away from the ties of fate that Gyro lacks. So when Johnny goes down to Ringo, he is shoved into a showdown that forces him to change. For the fleeting moment Gyro has to think before he enters the battle, the spirit of his father Gregorio appears, telling him what he's about to do is wrong. Using the family heirloom for the sake of saving Johnny is too sentimental, and it's antithetical to the art of execution, Gregorio says. If Gyro obeyed his father, he could stay on the same path his entire life, tied to the family profession, and always coming in second to those who push themselves down their own path. Of course, Gyro has shit to do, and the ghost of his stern father fades as his eyes are set ablaze with the dark determination that Ringo saw in Johnny. Gyro walks up to Ringo. Now, the opposing rocks are ready to spark. Gyro seeks to improve himself for the sake of others, namely Johnny and Marco, while Ringo thirsts for improvement at the expense of human life. This ideological battle really lets the beauty of the power system shine. To go back to Mandom, Ringo's stand, it manifests so that when he reverses time, the enemy stand user remembers what happened. Obviously, this allows the opponent to notice patterns in Ringo's strategy and possibly win. But that's exactly what Ringo wants, to put himself at the greatest disadvantage so he can overcome as much as humanly possible. This ability that grants him constant improvement allows him to chase divinity by overpowering opponents who have a leg up on him. However, Gyro becomes the first to exploit it. Gyro uses his memory of how the house crumbled in battle, putting Ringo on the defensive when a plank of wood impales him. A pretty funny bit of tragedy, considering how important the humble, secluded home is to what I have defined as the Jefferson Complex. But Gyro only won the physical battle. he still only reacted to Ringo's strategy and knocked him down, which isn't any different from his previous battles thus far. Gyro was still yet to confront his burden. Gyro needed to become his own man, create his own path. Ringo encourages Gyro to finish him off by throwing his final steel ball. He laments how the man who defeated him in battle is an example of what he believes to be a deteriorating country. As he says it, "The man and society are completely different ideals now." But the true road to victory requires the embracing of the true man's values. He tells Gyro, "Continue the race and find out for yourself the path of light. That is what I will pray for." As Ringo raises his gun after his hearty lecture, Gyro slings a steel ball into Ringo's chest without hesitation, finally putting the yeoman in as Ringo welcomes Gyro to the true man's world. So, obviously, in that moment, Gyro took Ringo's advice and acted on it. So, considering that, does that still make Ringo the villain of this arc? Yes, and if it weren't for the main villain of Steel Ball Run as a whole, I would say he's the best in all of JoJo, and this is especially impressive because he only has 3 chapters of screen time. So I think the reason why he's so compelling, maybe compared to other anime villains, is that Gyro learned a philosophical lesson from the man he defeated. Usually, you don't see that. Typically, the hero uses their victory over their enemy to fortify their own philosophy that already existed. But Ringo taught Gyro the importance of putting yourself out into the world as your own person, on your own terms, in order to achieve that mental fortitude. I think a whole change of mindset is something very impressive for a manga to do, and very challenging to achieve writing-wise. However, Gyro didn't just acquiesce to Ringo. That would have been pretty boring and forced, and you would lose any dramatic tension. What Gyro did is actively discard the faults of an extreme individualist ideology in order to create an identity that was truly his own. Gyro does this in the very last panel of chapter 35, which I think functions as an excellent thesis statement and general wrap-up for this arc. We see Gyro, just after finishing off Ringo, walking up to his collapsed partner, saying, "Looks like you still have a pulse, Johnny. You and me both." Gyro caring for his partner and showing sentimentality after defeating his opponent mentally is such a satisfying way to reconcile the past, burden Gyro, with Ringo and Gregorio's view on strict individualism. The final resolution creates a nuanced personality for Gyro. He can both defeat his enemies and show sentimentality at the same time. But I think the most important thing of all is that it gives the reader an incredibly optimistic philosophy that tells them they can improve themselves while still being a great companion. Overall, the way that Araki breaks down these macho men is very intricate, and more than anything, very interesting to explore. That you can't trust freedom when it's not in your hands, when everybody's fighting for the promised land. What I appreciate about JoJo's is how nuanced its approach is in representing a theme like individualism. Rather than having characters with different ideologies interacting with each other, characters of the same ideology often clash. The Civil War arc is almost like a philosophical dialogue playing out through a fight scene, where the characters' attacks symbolize elements of their philosophy. Also, in this fight specifically, Araki reaches a definitive conclusion on individualism, which I think is a rare sight to see nowadays. Our characters are following the MacGuffin, the corpse, and they find themselves in an abandoned church full of an assortment of trash. Johnny and Gyro start experiencing hallucinations of objects from their past, and when the stand user behind the attack appears from the shadows, all he repeats is, "Humans must sacrifice in order to progress." Both characters initially react by attempting to attack their hallucinations, along with the stand user, Axl Rowe. Yes, he is named after Axl Rose, obviously. But both of these strategies end up being futile. While Gyro helplessly shoots at his traumatic memories coming back to haunt him, Axl talks again. He says, "Will you retrieve what you left behind?" By mindlessly shooting, Gyro and Johnny alike are not retrieving what they left behind, their collective trauma. For Johnny, his shots constantly reach the mouse that tripped and killed his brother. But Johnny's shots never actually do damage or erase the mouse. Johnny is yet to confront his trauma. He can only attack it, try to make it disappear. Similarly, Gyro is faced with a room full of spinning steel balls, representing his psychological tie to his family profession, execution. Gyro can't seem to get rid of the steel balls, symbolizing how he feels trapped by his family ties. Just like how I talked about the positive aspects of Ringo's stand thematically, Axl Rose's stand has thematic purpose. Stan manifests attacks by tapping into the minds of Gyro and Johnny, haunting the pair with the trauma that he knows they can't confront. Stan even ramps up as the characters attack more. The hallucinations get worse as Johnny and Gyro attack with stronger hits, perhaps a physical manifestation of how addressing trauma in the wrong way can only make it worse to begin with. After his many attacks, Johnny eventually reaches a breaking point, the memory of his father wishing death upon him. So when the main character is at their lowest, and the dramatic tension is at its highest, what happens in the average battle manga? The main character makes a decision or compromise to increase his power in order to defeat the evil in a new way. Does this happen? Yes, but in the most bizarre way, as this manga loves to do. In Johnny's moment of despair, Jesus Christ himself appears behind Johnny to impart some wisdom. Why Jesus shows up at all could be its own video, but long story short, it's the corpse that everyone's after, and it's his corpse, so his spirit manifests itself to encourage positive moral use. But what Jesus says is very crucial. If your heart is wavering, do not shoot. The words of Jesus direct Johnny's attention away from what he's done so far, attack, and potentially sacrifice everything by doing so, to confront his trauma and achieve his goals. But Johnny still doesn't listen. He gives in to what Axl Rose tells him will give him victory. So Jesus continues his advice. He says, "If your heart is wavering, Johnny Joestar, do not shoot. You will never find the new path that way." By new path, I think Jesus is referring to the new type of sacrifice that Johnny must make to deal with his past. At that moment, Johnny's physical attacks clearly hadn't worked, so he was cornered into making a logical decision. In my opinion, his new type of sacrifice, a moral one, is more difficult than any physical damage he tanked in the story. We all like to think we have morals, but one of the most terrifying thoughts we can be confronted with are the consequences of actually being a moral actor. For example, the trolley problem. Most people agree it would be better to kill one person than to kill five, but the act of pulling the lever is just too brutal to swallow. It makes us think. If we can't act on our theory of morality, are all of our morals just superficial? Johnny answers with a resounding no. Johnny shoots himself with his own stand. As stands are a manifestation of the user's soul, it effectively allows Johnny to finally have the courage to look inwards. Johnny shooting himself allows him to realize why he is attacking his burden. As Jesus said before, his heart was wavering. He had no idea who he was, his trauma was unresolved, and yet he was going after a national organization trying to create a god. Johnny's new sense of self allows him to drop one of the best lines in the series, as he puts his first successful attack into Axl Rose and the hallucinations. He says, "If my heart is wavering, Gyro, don't shoot. I'm not wavering anymore." So, what does this battle have to say about individualism? Well, Johnny's evolution is contrasted by Axl Rose. When Johnny finally shoots him, Axl Rose activates his final ability, which transfers all of Axl Rose's sins onto Johnny. The story thus presents two ways of dealing with trauma, by examining it yourself or by putting it on others. Considering that Johnny comes out on top by making Axl Rose reverse the attack, Araki shows the strict pros and cons of individualism once again. On one hand, you can take the potentially easy way out by dumping your past onto others and moving on like nothing happened. On the other hand, you can take an incredibly hard, but honest, look at yourself and your past, and make your best effort to change. It's interesting to see how Araki depicts American individualism. Axl Rose is a Civil War character, and he's dressed in a full army uniform. He gives a warning to how Americans use it, by bearing it or throwing it onto others to pursue their own self-interest, while at the same time promoting a new, healthier way of looking at oneself, which he portrays through Johnny. It's important to remember that during the events of the story, Johnny is at his psychological and physical low point, so the fact that he's able to address his trauma at all is impressive, especially on the complete gambit that he's on. By means of Johnny being at rock bottom, Rocky tells us that regardless of whatever burden someone may have, they do have the ability to address it. Araki goes out of his way to say that this confrontation of self won't be easy. You may even have to do something incredibly scary, like shooting yourself with your magical stand. But you can't ignore it, and you certainly can't transfer it on to other people. Dirty deeds, done like cheap. Many manga readers debate the idea of an antagonist versus a villain, and the main villain of Steel Ball Run, Funny Valentine, is frequently put in the camp of antagonist. JoJo fans like to place him there because his moral complexity and the hero's doubts of his villainy in the final fight prove to be nuanced, but I think it's really important that we dig deeper into this character and train that skill of media comprehension. So, in order to do that, I'm going to break down why Valentine is most definitely a villain and not a morally righteous antagonist. Strangely, I'm going to start talking about this character by reviewing plot holes, which I usually try to stay away from because it's not a real criticism, let's be honest. It's something that comes from YouTube, and I don't like to take it seriously. But here, I'm going to use it to prove a point. So, Funny Valentine's stand ability, Dirty Deeds Done Dirt Cheap, commonly referred to as D4C, allows him to enter alternate dimensions, so when he's injured or in harm's way, he can train himself with a healthy, safe, alternate universe version of himself. When he acquires the corpse of Jesus Christ, the stand gains the ability to redirect any damage to a random person somewhere else in the world, which, in theory, would allow Valentine to use it in a large-scale war and direct all damage towards the US to their enemies, allowing the US to become the greatest nation on Earth. So when Valentine's swapping strategy was used multiple times, his primary ability, I began to think in the back of my mind, hold on, how do all these alternate Valentines know how to proceed exactly as the base Valentine did? That kinda doesn't really make sense. And I pretty much just buried the thought because I figured it was an unimportant mistake, but when we view Valentine as the manifestation of nationalism, as a symbol for it, I realized that he's consistent with one of the fundamental principles of nationalism. The loss of the individual to a homogeneous society. Nationalism is all about shared identity. It was initially used when the French Third Estate saw themselves as the only acceptable identity in French society. They used the shared pride to establish a government that they thought truly represented the country, rather than the pure monarchy. While useful to unite people, the identity aspect of nationalism is undoubtedly the most dangerous one, because if a government gets to decide what is or isn't a French person or a German person, nationalism can accelerate to an insane degree and you end up with the rule of the Nazi Party, which got to strictly define characteristics of what a citizen of their country was, while violently exterminating everyone else. So, how does Valentine reflect this idea? The alternate versions of himself knowing exactly what to do isn't a plot hole. In every one of the infinite universes, he is the same, with the same unwavering principles and motivations, because subjects of nationalism must precisely reflect the will of the nation or be deemed a traitor. If you aren't aligned with the determined well-being of the nation, how are you even a proper citizen? So when Valentine is trading places with another alt-Valentine, nationalism shows its tendency to take away the sense of a separate individual. If everyone is the same, there's no point in an individual to begin with. However, there is a problem that nationalism faces with taking away the individual, especially for a country like America who holds on to those individual rights like a toddler does to an iPad. That's to say, without understanding how or why they should have it. The way that nationalist states coddle the individual to thinking that they have any sort of free will is to make them the belief that they're making a valiant sacrifice of their effort, labor, or strength for the sake of their country. As Valentine describes the use of his upgraded stand, he says, "My actions were not done out of selfish desire. I do not wish to procure the corpse for the sake of power, or in order to control someone." This quote isn't insidious enough, given that he's directing damage towards everyone else in the world while the US can just chill. Take it from Benito Mussolini, who basically went bar for bar with Valentine when he said this. "We all know what motivates me is not a personal whim. It is not lust for power, it is not an ignoble passion, but only an unlimited and burning love for the fatherland." So Valentine's and Mussolini's statements both reflect how an individual can be manipulated into an action that is immoral because they see it as a net positive for the sake of their country. In Valentine's case, it's redirecting damage, and in Mussolini's case, it's obviously the rise of fascism. That is why in the United States, we all say the pledge, we sing the national anthem, and we constantly honor our troops who, thank God, protect our liberty overseas. But the thing we fail to consider is what the troops are really doing outside the bounds of the idea of a nation. To protect our liberty and commit the ultimate sacrifice, the US killed 300,000 Iraqis, dropped multiple weapons of human vaporization on Japan, and massacred over 1.1 million people in North Vietnam alone, all for the sake of protecting our liberty. corpse, Valentine's sacred MacGuffin to carry out his plan to make the US a dominant global force, perfectly encapsulates US imperialism. Valentine claims he must obtain it to secure American prosperity and values, and predicates this goal on the fact that there's no need to worry about where D4C's damage is going, because it's working for the good of the US, and the damage is directed at lowlifes anyways. This notion is established down to the name of the ability, Dirty Deeds Done Dirt Cheap, a euphemism for the results of domination. Valentine's backstory is also a great lesson on the dangers of nationalist propaganda, as it only appears to be a tragic triumph on the surface. Oddly, it's framed as a reference to the backstory of Bruce Willis's character in Pulp Fiction, which I still don't really understand why he chose that specifically, but anyways, great movie. But the equivalent of Christopher Walken's character comes in to tell a young funny Valentine about the story of his deceased father in a past war. His father's backstory is described in incredibly vague terms, stating that his father was a soldier in this country's army fighting against the enemy. Similar to the Pulp Fiction father, Valentine's dad mutilated himself to protect a family heirloom, only in Steel Ball Run, it's a handkerchief rather than a watch. Of course, his sacrifice is glamorized. The soldier goes to great lengths to explain to little funny Valentine why his father's sacrifice mattered. Risking one's life for the pride in their country, and thinking of it as an extension of protecting one's family, he says, is only a nobility of humanity. But given that line, it's easy to see how Valentine was imprinted by his father's story, given he repeats the same line to Johnny. Now, taking inspiration from your dad, who sacrificed everything for what you see as a good thing, doesn't seem so bad. Valentine was inspired by his father's heroism and decided to do the same, often using it as a symbol of his resolve. In fact, it's literally how he returns from certain death, using the handkerchief. I think, though, because Valentine never actually knew his father, the only emotion and resolve he's getting out of the handkerchief is what he derived from the guy who told him the story. And the main point of the story was to sacrifice for your country. I think this storytelling, and more importantly creating a national mythos for a country, is a huge part of the effectiveness of nationalism. Why is storytelling so effective at rallying people under a flag? Well, I think some quick history could teach us once again. After the ideas of the Enlightenment were popularized across Europe, certain groups opposed its ideas, namely Romanticism, which denied reason and the pursuit of objectivity in favor of sensualism and promotion of a subjective life. Naturally, this was applied to political philosophy, and German Romanticists saw it as an opportunity to organize their people under a unifying, passionate idea of what it is to be German through literature and art. The result is what we call the Sturm und Drang movement. I think Ryan Chapman summed up this movement best in his explanation of nationalism on YouTube.
They traveled the countryside in search of Germany's metaphorical interior. They looked for Germany's rhythm in bards and folk songs. They tried to capture the sensual power of its landscapes through poetry. They also philosophized about the German language, calling attention to its unique character, but then going even further, claiming that words aren't just things that describe the world, but allow you to feel the world from the inside.
Point is, storytelling allows a country to inject sensation into a people who otherwise may be opposed to homogenizing their political views through reason. Also, at the time, it helped that many people were uneducated, and thus strong internal feelings were especially appealing. I don't think romanticizing everything is always a bad thing, but the Valentine case is a cautionary tale. In the instance of Valentine, he extracted a feeling from a story of war, rather than truly internalizing the events and the ideologies at play. It's also especially egregious, given that his father was almost certainly fighting for the Confederates. Now that we've established that Valentine manifests himself as the politics of nationalism, I want to take a moment to appreciate how the manga executes this idea so well. For a manipulator like Valentine, it's important that the audience can actually see how parts of his lies are valid. A lot of this storytelling is done through Johnny, who, throughout the fight, questions whether his goals are morally inferior to Valentine's. Although the reader may identify Valentine's plans as absurd, because we, as the audience, get to sit with the events of the story, Johnny isn't afforded the same luxury, so it makes sense that he doubts himself. He must make decisions in the heat of the moment. Valentine is posturing as someone who makes supreme sacrifices for the good of an entire nation, while Johnny just wants to walk himself.
On top of the numerical comparison, though, Johnny feels an immense guilt because he feels like he was the cause of Gyro's death. Valentine's offer to bring back Gyro feels like it could ease that pain if Johnny just reverses his attack and spares Valentine. In other words, Johnny really does consider sparing Valentine because he has been shown to be so trustworthy from the start. All-encompassing plan, his honesty, and his general demeanor make him seem like he knows what he's doing. The image of careful calculation that Valentine brings to the pages creates a great drama, contrasted with Johnny's doubts about himself. And my favorite part about this conflict is how it forces the reader to use critical thinking to analyze the politics of the story. It asks to carefully consider Valentine's plan, and with that information in mind, definitively side against it.
Okay, hi, what's up? Thank you for sticking through with that video. I have no idea if anything I said was coherent or if it was just a bunch of words matched together. But anyways, I love writing about individualism and nationalism, and I hope I said something. It's one of my favorite topics to explore, or two of my favorite topics to explore in all of history. So yeah, I'm so happy that I got the opportunity to explore it so in depth about this series that I love so much. And yeah, I'm so grateful for that. And it's snowing outside, so that's pretty awesome. So yeah, bye-bye.